We were looking at jitter generation in a CDR, that is, if you have jitter free input data, and we'll assume alternating bit pattern as usual, just for the sake of analysis, then the output will still have jitter because of a number of reasons, because of noise in different components, the charge pump, the loop filter resistor and so on, and the phase noise of the VCO itself, plus because of periodic disturbances to the control voltage, there can also be some jitter, okay, which can be very quite significant in bang bang with bang bang phase detectors. Okay. So, as usual, we will initially do the analysis with alternating bit patterns and assuming a linear phase detector. After that, we know that at least the average behavior, as far as the average behavior is concerned, you can multiply the charge pump gain by the transition density and use the same expressions. Okay. The randomness in the data will have some effect, but we do not have to worry about that. And there is some, especially as far as jitter generation is concerned, bang bang detectors, which are very useful, will have a lot of jitter of their own, systematic jitter, not because of component noise. That also we will talk about. Okay. So, we saw that basically the transfer function to the output from the charge pump noise is simply the same as that from phi out, phi into phi out divided by the gain of the charge pump, right. And what was this? What's that? Yeah, 2 pi by, there is a 2 pi also. Okay. One here, right? Or S, okay, S. This was SCR 1 plus SCR plus S square C by ICP times KVCO. And finally, phi out by the phase noise of the VCO . This one is nothing but phi out by phi in, right, except for a gain factor. So, it has a low frequency gain of 2 pi by ICP, okay. And this is omega z, that is 1 by RC, okay, that is the 0 frequency. We know that there is a pole 0 doublet here, so there is probably some slight peaking that is not very important in this case, and then it does that, right. So, it is almost like a first order low pass filter with a bandwidth equal to the bandwidth of the CDR omega u loop. Okay. And phi out by VNR, what does that look like? It is basically, if you look at the denominator, it has two roots, one near 1 over CR and one near omega u loop. Okay. And this factor is increasing with frequency. So, essentially what you get is okay. So, you have plus 20 dB per decade here, minus 20 dB per decade there, and some flat region in the Bode sense between omega z and the bandwidth. Okay. So the noise from the resistor matters for some intermediate range of frequencies. Well above the bandwidth it doesn't matter, and then well below the zero also it doesn't matter. Okay. By the way, this also has some gain with some dimensions, and that is 2 pi divided by ICP times R. Okay. And finally, phi out by the phase noise of the VCO. What does that look like? So, it is a high pass, it also has two breakpoints. Okay. So, it looks like that, and the very high frequency gain is 1 or 0 dB. Okay. And that makes sense because there is hardly any feedback beyond the bandwidth, and the jitter in the VCO comes out directly to the output. Okay. Now, we assumed like white noise in these two components, in the charge pump and the resistor. Okay. So, to find the noise due to the charge pump current, what do you have to do? Yeah, you have to take the spectral density of the charge pump current, which is SICP. We said basically this is roughly speaking 8 by 3 kT times the average GM of the two charge pump sources, right. At least in a linear phase detector, when it is locked, each of the current sources is on for half the time. So, if you take the average GM, it is fine. Okay. Whatever it is, you take that and then you have to multiply it by the magnitude squared of this. This gives you the spectral density due to the charge pump current. Okay. Spectral density of what? Output phase. Okay. This is the spectral density of the output phase. What does that mean? That is an ideal periodic output clock would be like that. Okay. In reality, it will have deviations in every edge. Okay. Some will be earlier, some will be later, and so on. Now, what does the randomness in phase mean? Basically, you look at the deviation between the position of the ideal edge and the position of the actual edge in radians. Okay. This is here we are talking about phase. You can express this in radians, you can express this in picoseconds, whatever it is, but in this case when you talk about phi out, this is in radians. So, you look at how much each edge deviates from the ideal periodic edges by how many radians, and then when we talk about phase as a random variable, it is this variable that we are talking about, deviation from the ideal zero crossings. Okay. So, as usual, this phase is a sampled quantity. You can sample it maybe once or maybe twice a cycle, because you have both the rising and falling edges, but we still think of it as a continuous time quantity. Now, for frequencies well below the frequency of the clock, that is a reasonable approximation. Okay. Is this fine? Again, what does this randomness mean? You make a million CDRs, right, and then you have also magically an ideal periodic clock with exactly the same average frequency. Okay. Then you look at the deviation of each of these, the edges of each of these clocks compared to the ideal one, and then you can plot the statistics of it, right. You can find the variance, you can also look at it over time, you can find the autocorrelation, and you can take the Fourier transform of the autocorrelation, you get the spectral density. So, this spectral density is, that is what it is, and that variance, that simply you look at how much it is varying. So, as usual, if you look at, if you plot the histogram of the variation, it will be a Gaussian. Okay. That is, the mean value will be centered around the ideal, but it can deviate from the ideal one. Okay. Now, of course, there is some subtleties here. This Gaussian can extend to infinity. Now, you can wonder what that means. I mean, if this edge goes beyond that edge, what does it even mean? I mean, does the whole period disappear? But let us not worry about it. The variance is going to be much smaller than a period. So let's not worry about this this edge going beyond the next edge and so on, that kind of stuff. So we can approximate this to be a Gaussian and move on. Okay, and the variance of the standard deviation of this, right? So the standard deviation of this phase, that is known as the RMS jitter. Okay. This is nothing but standard deviation of the phase of clock edges compared to an ideal periodic clock. Again, we have to discuss some other details. In some cases, you can't find this and so on. By the way, this is what is known as absolute jitter. That is, we are comparing it to an ideal periodic clock and taking the total deviation from there. There are other measures of jitter that we will see. We will simply look at the width of each period and then see how it compares to the ideal, right? That is one possibility and so on. So, in this case, this is the absolute jitter. Now, again, if you look at let's say what comes out of this calculation of spectral density, this answer will be in radians. Okay, this will be in radians, but jitter typically is expressed in units of time. Okay, so how do you convert this to time jitter? Yeah, so basically, they go from phase to period, it is basically phi divided by 2 pi times the period of the clock. Okay. So, here also, if you have the standard deviation in terms of radians, you can get the standard deviation in seconds by sigma phi divided by 2 pi times T s. Okay. Now, you can also express this in just unit intervals, that is essentially without this T s. You only say how much, what is the fraction of the period, you do not worry about exact period, right. That is simple also. If you want it in UI, you would take sigma phi divided by 2 pi, that is all, right. 2 pi is one period, sigma phi divided by 2 pi is the fraction of a period, that is all. Is it okay? The same thing can be expressed in many ways, but the notion of absolute jitter, hopefully that is clear. You have an ideal periodic clock, everything like all this noise related stuff, right. You can mentally imagine some experiment. You have some ideal experiment without noise, and then you have the noisy experiments, and you compare the noisy to the ideal in some way. Okay. In this case, what we are doing is, we have an ideal periodic clock, and you have clock width, which is not, which is just the same average frequency, right. So, for every edge of that, you will have an edge of this in the same time, but the location of the edge can be different from the ideal one. Okay. So, then you look at how much it is deviating, and you can plot all kinds of statistics of the deviation, just like any other random variable, right. The mean is 0, we assume that it is centered with the, or rather by definition, we center the ideal clock around the mean of this, at the mean of this. Then you have the standard deviation or variance if you want, then you can have spectral density and so on. Okay. Standard deviation is sort of an aggregate measure, it just tells you how much it is spread out. The spectral density tells you how it is varying with time also, right. Because whether the next one, does it have any correlation with this one, or is it completely different, I mean completely uncorrelated. Okay. So, in this case, it will be correlated to some extent. Clearly, this is not white, right. If this is white, this, you understand this, right. This part is white, that is constant with frequency, but this transfer function is not constant with frequency. So, the resulting spectral density, it is not constant with frequency. So, in fact, it has this low pass shape. So, what does it mean? If it has a low pass shape, that is correct. In terms of correlations, what can you say? Yeah, it is related to, I mean, you have the frequency domain transfer function and the impulse response. So, there is some relationship. If the frequency domain transfer function has a low bandwidth, this will, the, in the time domain, it will appear in some way. It is the same relationship between spectral density and autocorrelation. So, what can you say about that? At low frequencies, they are correlated. What does it mean? So, okay, let me ask you this. So, I have some deviation at this edge and I look at the very next edge, okay, will there be correlation or not? No, this is, this axis here is time, okay. So, I look at this particular edge, I look at the next edge, will there be correlation or not? First of all, this bandwidth, right, this is going to be much smaller than the data rate, okay. Here I showed you, like, how far is this? This is one edge, this is the next clock edge, right, this is a TS, okay. Now, the bandwidth of the CDR is going to be much smaller than FS, otherwise in fact all the continuous time approximations that we made doesn't even work. Okay. That is, no CDR will actually correct, at least the ones that are that I know in practice. It cannot correct something from one edge of the clock to the next. Okay. It sort of takes an average measure and over time, over many edges of the clocks, it gives you a correction. Okay. So, that means that this omega u loop is going to be much smaller than 2 pi times f s anyhow, okay, where f s is the data rate. So, then what can you say? Is it correlated or not? This edge with this edge, it is correlated, right. So, for short time scales it is correlated and for long time scales it is not, okay. So, you should again at least have an intuitive feel for this. So, let us again do this with the first order case. First, let me take this transfer function, okay. This, you know, I mean. Right, this is how it is in the frequency domain, this is how it is, okay. What is the impulse response of this? If this is the transfer function, what is the impulse response? What is it? So, this is P 1 by P 1 plus S, right. So, basically P 1 exponential minus P 1 t, that is the impulse response, okay. Now, this by itself may not say things, many things. So, let us say I reduce the bandwidth of this, what happens to that one? Yeah. So, basically it will, I mean, because we have this factor P 1 here, it may be smaller, but it will be like that, okay. It is exactly the same relationship between autocorrelation function and the spectral density, okay. So, let us say now, the spectral density is the same thing, but you know that it is a magnitude square, right. A spectral density is always a real number with which is symmetrical, of course. So, now this also looks the same way, right. In a Bode plot sense, it is exactly the same. I will draw only the positive part of the spectral density, okay. What will be the autocorrelation corresponding to this? What is the autocorrelation of this, do you know? No. You are thinking of squaring this, but that is not what I am doing, okay. This is the magnitude square. First of all, what is the, I mean, what you do, what do you expect this function to be? This is, let us say, the spectral density of some random variable. Okay. The spectral density is a purely real number. Okay. What do you expect the autocorrelation to be? No, no, forget the exact shape. Huh? No, no. No, I mean, if the spectral density is real, or okay, forget the spectral density stuff, even in the, if you have a real signal, okay, that is the signal itself is real, what is the Fourier transform? What do you expect in the Fourier transform domain? Symmetric, right? So, here the spectral density is real, what do you expect in the autocorrelation? The autocorrelation will be symmetric, that you anyway expect, right? For whether you take a time shift of plus t or minus t, it will be the same. So, in fact, the Fourier transform of this, I think if you remember the standard tables, what is that? It is also an exponential, but what is that? The shape, I am not writing the scaling factor, it is basically p 1 magnitude of t. Okay. So, it will look like that, right? And if you narrow the bandwidth, what happens is it will spread out. Okay. If you have 0 bandwidth, basically you have DC, so that means it is the same everywhere. Okay. On the other hand, if you go on widening the bandwidth, this thing becomes sharper and sharper, and finally, what happens? It becomes an impulse, okay, where it is correlated only at that time instant and not with any other time instant. Okay. So, basically that is what it means. Now, we have to have the scale also here, I did not put the frequency scale, but this is what bandwidth means in terms of random variables. It is actually the same thing, it is I mean in case of deterministic signals, if you know the Fourier transform, you know exactly what the signal is. In this case, if you know the spectral density, you of course, cannot tell what the noise is, but you can tell what the correlation is. If it is low bandwidth, it means that it is correlated for longer times. If it is high bandwidth, it is correlated only for shorter times, and that makes sense, right? Low bandwidth means it is varying slowly. So, it cannot in a short while, it cannot change so much that it becomes uncorrelated. Similarly, high bandwidth means it can change more rapidly. So, in a short while, it could become uncorrelated. Yeah, there was a question. Yeah. No, it only tells you how the noise changes with time. Okay. For instance, I mean, let us say you throw dice, right? I mean, if you throw a fair dice, I mean, or in fact, any dice, what you get in the first throw, what you get in the second throw has got nothing to do with the first one, right? It is completely uncorrelated. But you have these other processes where it can be correlated. Okay. So, autocorrelation only tells you, essentially it tells you like how much the noise, how the noise is at some time compared to some other time. That is whether you can say something about the noise at time t 2 by looking at the noise time, noise at time t 1. Okay. Which one? Which one of this one? No, that is this, right? The Fourier transform is this. Inverse Fourier transform or Fourier transform are the same thing, right? Except for some sign change. No, no, no. So, I think you are mixing up stuff. So, the Laplace transform of this one is s by s square plus omega naught square and sin omega naught t, this is omega naught by s square plus omega naught square. If you want the Fourier transform and you substitute s equals j omega, you get here j omega by omega naught square minus omega square. By the way, you know that for this, this is not the Fourier transform, you also need to add some impulsive components. Okay. So, and here also this becomes omega naught square minus omega square, but we have plus omega square there, not minus. So, it is not sinusoidal. Okay. So, if we have plus omega naught square plus omega square, in fact, it is like that, it is not sinusoidal, it is this exponential. Okay. So, correlation refers to (clears throat) correlation basically refers to how things change with time. Okay, that's all I can say. Essentially, if you look at the definition of a correlation, when you evaluate the correlation at a particular time shift tau, what you are doing is expected value of x of t plus tau or minus tau, it doesn't matter. Okay. Now, let's take the usual case where x of t is 0 mean. Okay. Then also, let's say this x of t plus tau is completely independent of x of t. This is what happens when you toss coins or when you throw dice. The second throw has got nothing to do with the first throw. Okay. So, you know that when these are independent, it simply becomes e of x of t, e of x of t plus tau. Okay. So, in this case, and then if x itself has 0 mean, then each of these is 0 and then there is nothing to, there is no correlation at all, that is what it means. Okay. If the value at t plus tau is somehow influenced by t, okay, then you will have some correlation. Okay. So, if here you have slow changes, or you can define processes like, let us say you have coin tosses, this is actually a two valued function. So, let me call this some x of n is either plus 1 or minus 1, let us say depending on heads or tails. Now, I define something else y of n to be x of n plus x of n minus 1 plus x of n minus 2. Okay. Now, this has 8 possible values, but not only that, this value, the value at n is generated from 3 previous values at 3 values of x, 3 consecutive values of x. Okay. So, let us say you have, this is just the index. So, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 and so on. Okay. Now, if you look at it, one value of y is generated from those, the other one is generated from those and the next one from those and so on. In this case, you do expect some correlation between this y and that y, right, because these two are common. So, typically when you have the same physical origin for two different times, then you can expect some correlation. Okay. You still have to calculate what it is. Is this clear? I mean, we unfortunately do not have time to go too much into the random process stuff, but essentially it is a measure of whether you can say something about the random process, random variable at a particular time by looking at it at a previous time. And you can intuitively feel that if it is a low pass process, that is if it is changing slowly, you can probably tell, right. If it is a very low pass, if it is a low pass, if let us say noise, let me look at this, not this one. Let us say in this particular case, this bandwidth is 1 megahertz, okay. And you look at, and you have a 10 gigahertz clock, and you look at consecutive cycles, they are 100 picoseconds apart. And the bandwidth of this is only 1 megahertz. So, you can tell that not much has changed between 0 and 100 picoseconds, or maybe even 10 cycles apart, that is still only 1 nanosecond. Okay. So, then they will be highly correlated. In fact, the values may likely to be, maybe are likely to be the same, right. It changes slowly. So, that is what it means. Okay. Much worse than what? No, what gets accumulated? Yeah. Yeah, yeah. So basically, you are saying much. I think what you are saying is that. Let's see. How do I put this? So, here we are talking about jitter generation, right. This is simply even if you have an ideal clock, the output clock will have some jitter, that is what we are talking about here. Okay. But I think your actually your question is more related to the jitter transfer. So if the input clock has jitter, how much of it gets transferred? If it gets corrected after some time, whether it is actually correcting in the right direction or not. Okay. Now you can do that in the time domain, but the easier thing is in the frequency domain itself, right? So we have looked at phi out minus phi in for calculating the jitter tolerance. Okay. Now it can end up being worse. We in fact saw a case of that. If the damping factor is small, it can have a peak. Okay. So if the delay in the loop is a certain amount, you can have a peak, right, in the transfer function. So in fact, this is a case where it is getting worse. The jitter is actually more than the input jitter, right? So essentially, it is like correcting in the wrong direction. Okay. So that's basically it. It can happen. I mean, if you have jitter peaking, the output jitter can be more than the input jitter. So it can be that essentially the correction is not applied in the right direction. Okay. Now, if it is not peaky, but if it is merely very low bandwidth, what it means is it takes a long time to offer any corrections. This means that basically if the input jitter is changing slowly, it will track it. If it is fast, it can't do anything, it just doesn't react to it, that's all, right. The instantaneous value of noise is not predictable. You can of course, you know the statistics of noise. Okay. No, it is not becoming predictable in that you can't tell the value at a particular time, right. So, meaning so I make, let us say, 1 million low pass filters. Usually, I mean, I think if you recall the treatment of noise, you do this. First you talk about this ensemble average, right. What does it mean? You basically do the experiment infinite number of times. You have an ensemble, you do it lot of times and then look at the result, because you can't tell anything from each one. I look at, let us say, one low pass filter, I plot the noise, it looks like that. I mean, that does not mean that I make one more, it will look the same way. So, I mean, it is like I ask one person, it will give some random answer, I do not know what it is. Okay, then the best thing I can do is ask a lot of people and then find out what the answer is and see if there is some statistical property I can get out of this. So, I make this million low pass filters. So, if I look at the values at a particular instant of time, they will all be different from each other. Okay. In fact, one may be 0, one may be plus something, one may be minus something, anything. You can't tell what that value is. Now, what can you tell? First, if you plot the histogram of all the values at a particular instant, it will be some Gaussian. Okay. With some variance. This is known, okay, because the noise of many natural things are Gaussian and a resistor's noise is also Gaussian. So, that is a measure of the size of noise. You can't tell how much the noise is, but you can tell how much the noise variance is, right. You have lots of this filters, right. So, let us say the noise variance comes out to be noise standard deviation. Okay. So, if you plot the histogram of the measured noise at a particular instant, it will come out like this. Okay. It will be Gaussian. And let us say the sigma is 1 microvolt. Okay. And you also know from the property of the Gaussian distribution that if you go, let us say, beyond plus minus 3 sigma, you do not have too many values. Of course, in principle you have values all the way till infinity, but you are not likely to get too many. So, then what can you say from this? While you cannot tell how much the instantaneous noise is, you can say that, hey, the noise is not likely to be beyond plus minus 3 microvolt. That is the, I mean, that is the statistical statement, right. See, like actually we also, engineers also use all this statistical stuff quite carelessly. So, when we say all these things, we should also, I think you would have studied all this in maths, which I also studied and then do not use anymore. So, all this business of confidence intervals and so on, right. So, I should actually say that I will not see noise beyond plus minus 3 microvolt with some probability. Okay. So, that is the correct statement. So, I do not actually do that, but so, for an engineer, I look at 1 microvolt and say, hey, I am probably not going to get more than 3 microvolts, and then if I design my circuits to tolerate 3 microvolts, I am fine. Okay. So, that is the statement, that is one. Okay. Next is correlation. So, here also, I mean, anyway you can't tell what the noise is at let us say t equal to 0. Okay. So, let us say you look at t equal to 0 and t equal to 1 microsecond. Now, can you say something about this? So, to figure that out, this is what I calculate. Again, this expectation means averaging over the ensemble. I have a million low pass filters. I take the value at t equal to 0, I mean t is 0 here and this tau is 1 microsecond. So, I form these products, okay, and I calculate this average. What could it be? First of all, I am looking at tau equals 1 microsecond. Now, if the bandwidth of this filter or if the RC time constant is much smaller than 1 microsecond, okay, then things would have changed a lot. Okay, then actually if I calculate this average, it will come out to be 0, right. So, basically it means that I mean I cannot look at this t equal to 0 and then 1 microsecond later, the 1 microsecond later value does not have, I mean I cannot, it just seems to have no relationship to this, right. Okay. But let us say the bandwidth, the RC time constant was 1 millisecond. Okay. So, you know that the you do not know the voltage on each capacitor, you do not know the voltage at the output of each low pass filter. But you do know that if the RC time constant is 1 microsecond, sorry 1 millisecond, over a 1 microsecond period it is not going to change much, right, that you know. Okay. So, then this autocorrelation will come out to be a high value. Okay. So, that is what it means. So, this you cannot tell how much the noise is, but in this case you can tell that hey, if the value at t equal to 0 is something, the value at t equal to 1 microsecond is likely to be the same thing. Okay. It will of course, vary a little bit, but not too much, right. So, that is the statement we make while talking about random processes and correlation and so on. So, that is what correlation means. Okay. So, in this particular case I took 1 microsecond as an example. So, if the bandwidth is much higher than let us say 1 megahertz or 1 megaradians per second, then over 1 microsecond it just changes so much that I cannot tell anything from anything. Whereas, if the bandwidth happened to be much smaller than that, then over 1 microsecond it hardly changes. Okay. So, you take your intuition from the deterministic stuff, right, there also. So, if you have 1 megahertz bandwidth filter, you look at its impulse response, sorry 1 gigahertz bandwidth filter, look at its impulse response, it would have died out well before 1 microsecond. Okay. Similarly, you take a 1 kilohertz bandwidth and look at its impulse response, over 1 microsecond it is probably a constant. Okay. It is the same thing here, but it applies to correlations. The point is you do not know, because of randomness you do not know what the value of each instance is. But if you look at a lot of them, you can say something about the average behavior of the random process. Okay. So, that is like a 5-minute primer on a random process course, but I think you can refer to the random process textbooks. But I mean initially this ensemble average business can be confusing. It is basically like looking at I cannot tell what each one is. So, I look at a whole collection of them and then say something about the collective behavior. Okay. That is basically what it is. Fine. And then in lot of cases, not in every case, actually the VCOS noise itself will be a little bit weird as we will see. In a lot of cases, you average over the ensemble, that is you make a million copies of the low pass filter and then look at the output of all of them at a particular instant and take these statistics, or you look at one low pass filter, you sample it over a million different time instants and take the statistics, they will be the same. In many cases, those processes are known as ergodic processes, but this is not always the case as we will see. Okay. Any questions? So, here again we are looking at phase in particular. So, we are looking at an ideal clock and a real clock whose edges are deviated from the ideal, and what we are plotting are the properties of the deviations. Okay. So, again, if these two edges are let us say 10 gigahertz clock, they are 100 picoseconds apart, the bandwidth of your clock and data recovery circuit is let us say 1 megahertz, then clearly the noise due to charge pump is not going to change so much from here to there. Okay. So, both edges will be deviated from the same amount, by the same amount, though you do not know what it is, I mean you only know its variance. Okay. Is this fine? So, this itself is a low pass process with some variance. Now, how do you calculate the variance? I want to calculate the jitter due to this. How do I do that? This only tells me the spectral density, right, as a function of frequency. I just want, let us say I did this experiment, I have a special CDR where of course, the input is, input has no jitter. And no component has noise, the VCO does not have phase noise, the resistor does not have noise, but only the charge pump has noise. And I have the output clock, you expect it to be noisy, meaning its edges will have deviations. I just want the sigma of the deviation. How do I get that? Yeah, so this is important. You have the spectral density and you integrate this from 0 to infinity, you get the variance. Okay. So, let us say this is the spectral density and it is the Fourier transform pair is the spectral density and the autocorrelation function, right. So, that means that the spectral density is the Fourier transform of the, this is tau, sorry. Right. And then similarly, I will, sorry. So, by the way, I will write it like this. This is the standard notation. This, these formula are true for two-sided spectral densities. Okay. For one-sided, spectral density anyway is symmetrical. I just have to double the value. There will be some factor of 2 here. I do not want to include that, but you get the idea. Okay. And somehow in circuit design, typically it is common to use one-sided spectral density for most cases. Sometimes we use two-sided, but most of the time we use one-sided. Okay. So, this is what it is. Now, if you look at the second expression and if you substitute r x of 0, I mean tau equal to 0, what do you get? Integral of s x over the entire range of frequency. And what is r x of 0? Autocorrelation at time shift equal to 0 is a correlation with itself. It is just a variance. Okay. R x of 0, this is sigma x square, okay, which is nothing but the integral of the spectral density over all frequencies. Now, if it is one-sided spectral density, you should take the integral obviously from 0 to infinity of s x of f dF, okay, if this is one-sided. These will give the same values. The one-sided spectral density will have twice the value of the two-sided spectral density. So, if you integrate that from 0 to infinity or this from minus infinity to infinity, you get the same value. Okay. So, clearly to get the amount of jitter, you have to integrate this from 0 to infinity. Okay. Now, sometimes there is a problem. Right now, this is okay. You can see that if I had included flicker noise of the transistors, that will not converse because that goes to infinity at 0 frequency. In fact, we have lots of even theoretical difficulties with flicker noise. Let us not worry about that, but this is what it is. Similarly, what is the effect of this? I mean, what is the spectral density due to this? This is the transfer function. So, what will be the spectral density? It will be basically the noise spectral density of the resistor, which is 4 kTr times phi out by Vnr square. Okay? And if you integrate this, you get the jitter only due to the resistor. As long as we stick to like white noise here and there, this, these integrals do converge. Okay, there is no problem. Okay. And as far as the VCO's noise is concerned, again it is the same thing. So, you have to multiply it by the spectral density of the VCO's phase noise times phi out by phi VCO square. This is the spectral density due to VCO's phase noise, and if you integrate this, you get the jitter. But the spectral density of VCO's phase noise is not white. What it is, we will see in the next class. Okay. Any questions? Please think about this. Unfortunately, we do not have too much time to get into details of random process and noise calculations. I will only do that much that is required for us to be able to go ahead with the calculation. At the same time, if you are really confused about some part, please do raise it, because if something is not at all clear, then you may not be able to do the calculation at all. Okay. So, for us, we need to be able to I mean, generally the circuit design stuff goes like this. You typically work with spectral densities. So, you have to calculate transfer functions, which of course all of you know, and you need to know the spectral density of noise of some basic components like the resistor and MOS current source and VCO and so on. Okay? So, resistor and current source we know, VCO we will deal with in the next class. Okay? And finally, you need to know what to do with the spectral density. Like all these things are somewhat abstract, right? There are some abstract measures of something. Finally, they relate to something real. A clock comes out, its edges are not periodic. All this information is about how unperiodic or how aperiodic that is. Okay? So, we have to be able to calculate that part.